everybody. We're back here up on the Samsung stage at E3 2014. I'm Sean McInnes, and I'm joined by Nick here, who's going to show us a little bit of Stronghold Crusader 2.
Yeah,
Nick, thanks for swinging by.
You're very welcome.
All right, so for anybody who's not familiar with the Stronghold Crusader series, what's it all about? What are you guys doing with the second one?
So it's kind of a mix between the city builder and sim genres, you know, that plus RTS. So you've got your, you know, your simulation games, your Tropicos, your Banished. It's kind of that with a layer of sort of combat on top of it. So you've got your popularity, your, you know, your peasants, your castle, your economy. You have to keep that supplied, but it's also got this layer of sort of combat on top of it, where, you know, you have to raise an army, you have to attack the opposing lord, you have to destroy his castle. So yeah, it's kind of a mix between those two genres.
All right, so we've actually, this is not footage, this is a live demo that we're checking out, right?
Yeah.
So go ahead and give us the play-by-play. What's going on here? What stage of the game is this?
Sure, so this is a sort of simple 1v1 skirmish match. Skirmish mode is a huge part of the game. It's, you know, where the replayability is, it's RTS, you know, the skirmish mode is a huge part of that. So Paul is playing against Richard the Lionheart, who is one of 8 different AI characters that the game will ship with. Each has got their own unique castle design, their own preferences when it comes to troop types, their own strategies. Some are a bit more straightforward. Richard's more on the honorable side of things, you know, so he'll attack you straight on with, you know, Crusader units and siege equipment. Other AI characters are a little bit more devious, you know,
sure.
They use like fire traps, stake traps and things like that. So Paul's just kind of building up his castle economy, which is basically the bedrock of any sort of successful attack. In Stronghold, to recruit troops, you need armor, you need weapons. So that's maces, lances, swords. And to generate all those things, you need an economy. So Paul here is building up a sort of, you know, weapon production sort of sweatshop in that
right.
In the sense that he's placing his buildings really close together so the peasants don't have to travel too far. You've got his stockpile sort of in the bottom of the screen there where you can see all his wood, his stone, and his iron. Wood is used to make buildings, stone is used to design your castle, and iron is used to make weapons. So you can see all the peasants traveling between the different buildings there. You know, so the closer you place your buildings to each other, the more efficient the economy will be, the faster you'll produce troops, the faster you'll produce weapons and armor. But the sort of flip side of that is that fire plays quite a big role in the game. It's set in a desert, there's not too much water, so if someone sets fire to one of your buildings, it'll spread quite quickly. So you've got to watch out for that. But Paul's generally building an efficient castle economy, you know, to sort of support his army. So there's 2 buildings there you can see, the barracks, which is kind of built into the castle walls, so you can send troops up there and position along the walls. And then you've got the mercenary camp. So the barracks, you can recruit Crusader troops. These guys require a little bit of gold, but it's mainly like they need weapons, they need armor to produce. So you need like a fully functioning economy before you can produce these guys. But generally speaking, they're the strong, you know, units. They're the long-term strategy in the game. The other building, the little sort of white tent there to the right-hand side, is the mercenary post. So these guys don't require any weapons because they bring their own, but they are quite expensive in terms of gold. So if you have, you know, getting attacked, you've run out of troops and you're up against the wall, you can kind of sell all your resources at the stockpile and kind of hire these like mercenaries for hire, essentially. But
okay.
Paul's generally just getting his, you know, his defenses built up and getting ready for Richard to attack him and try and destroy his beautiful castle that he's made.
Right. See if we've got any questions on Twitter yet. Nick, I'll just ask you to do a quick favor and just slide a little closer my way. It's very loud, as you can tell.
Yeah, I mean,
out
we're,
here.
We're fortunate enough to be out in the Airstream lot across the road, so it's
right.
A bit more civilized over there. But yeah, it's loud in here. You have my sympathies.
All right. I'm doing my best, though. So let's see. Let's jump back into the narration for a moment. I might have missed this earlier, but what is the goal that we're actually trying to achieve here?
So the traditional goal in your average skirmish game, because the game will come with a fully featured series of campaigns, so single player campaigns, one from a Crusader point of view, one from the Arab point of view. But in the sort of the skirmish mode, the general sort of aim of the game is to kill the enemy lord. So it's like victory by regicide, basically.
Yeah.
So he's kind of building up his defenses now, and after he's defended against this kind of first wave of attack, he's probably going to start building up some siege equipment, blasting down the enemy walls, and trying to kill King Richard, essentially. You can see Paul's placed some fire traps there. So those actually won't be visible to the enemy. The stakes will, but the fire traps won't be. So they might move their forces close in, and Paul can actually fire an arrow into them and set the pitch on fire.
Mm-hmm.
And sort of it's sort of a set fiery trap. And you can see on the left and right-hand side there, they've got sort of these cages with war dogs inside. So those will kind of like break out once the enemy draws near and sort of, you know, just attack them wildly. But it's, you know, we want to give people as many options when it comes to defend their castle as possible. So,
yeah,
you know, you've got burning oil, you've got archers and towers, you've got, you know, braziers, they can fire fire arrows. So there are lots of options when it comes to that. And as you can see, it's very easy for Paul to create new walls, build some more towers. You can layer up walls very easily. And it's funny, because the original Crusader actually came out in 2002.
Mm-hmm.
And it was 2D, right? So there were a few things about the gameplay, like everything was on a grid. And, you know, even though that was kind of a restriction, it really worked well for the gameplay. So what we've tried to do in Crusader 2 is kind of bring that 2D style gameplay into the 3D engine. So it looks fantastic. You know, it's got the havoc physics in there for castle destruction, all that kind of stuff. But
mm-hmm.
it kind of plays like the original game. And we were at PAX East recently, and you know, people were sort of giving us feedback saying that it feels like the original game, which is, you know, a massive, massively encouraging thing for teams to hear. But it's totally up to you how you build your castle. Paul's layered up some walls there so he can place more archers on them. He's built a couple more towers. Towers will generally give archers like a range advantage. They're harder to hit up there. Towers are a bit stronger than your average wall. But yeah, if you place the archers along the walls, as Paul has on the left-hand side, they're slightly exposed there. And if Richard comes and knocks those walls down, the archers are just going to come tumbling off.
Right.
It's probably one of the most satisfying things to destroy someone else's castle after they spent like an hour building it up.
Sure. Now, it's got to be interesting working on the second game so long after the first one, because people tend to think of strategy as kind of a retro genre, but it's really not. It's changed and evolved a lot over time. Genre standards have changed. How does that kind of affect your guys' development on Stronghold Crusader 2?
So it's funny, because we are, even though the company's been around since 99, we're actually a really small team. There's only five core devs working on Crusader 2. So we kind of like trying to punch above our weight a little bit. You know, we're not AAA, but we're kind of AA.
Right.
So like the game comes with like all the kind of things you expect from a full price RTS game, like campaigns, free build, multiplayer. We've got a co-op mode in there as well, so
Richard's
two players can
attacking.
Control the same castle, sort of manage the economy together and send out attacks and sort of, you know, share their resource pools. But it's kind of like we have to use the things that, you know, we haven't got the resources to produce like AAA stuff all the time, so we kind of have to make smart decisions when it comes to how to introduce something new. So like,
ready?
We want to make a game that's not just sort of the same as the original Crusader, because the thing is, when you've got people that love the original game so much, they basically want you to just make the same thing all over again. And we want to capture the spirit of the original game, but we want to make something new, because it's a sequel, right? It's not,
sure.
It's not a remake. So what we've done is we've kind of taken the blueprint of the original game. One or two units had these special unit abilities. The assassin could climb walls, the horse archer could shoot while moving, and kind of applied that to the rest of the units in the game. So we've kind of taken the core and not sort of thrown loads of money at it, but kind of thought about how can we expand the game in a sort of natural way that doesn't really wreck the template, but kind of expands on it a little bit. And it's sort of like we're using the blueprint of the original game to sort of, you know, expand and make it the kind of game that we wanted it to be in the first place.
So this little scenario that we're seeing here, how does this compare with the general scope of the game?
Right, so this is like a medium-sized map. The game supports up to 8 players, so it goes all the way from small to extra large. And this is kind of like a typical example of a skirmish trail mission, so not part of the main story. The main stories will be sort of more pre-built, more sort of elaborate maps. But this is a good example of like a typical sort of skirmish mission on the skirmish trail. So we have a sort of a sequence of missions that we set and we design, and it's something to give players to do after they've completed the main campaign.
Right.
So you can see the physics, the wall destruction there at work, and that's kind of a way where, you know, we haven't created our own engine. We're using the Havoc Vision engine, so that comes with all these sort of things built in. And you can see the archers falling off there as well. So it's kind of one way we can, you know, we've got that tech already built, so then we can kind of tweak it and make sure it works nicely and get the sort of the weight of the stones feeling just right and the sort of effects, and spend time tweaking stuff rather than making it from scratch, basically.
Mr. No Life on Twitter asks, how many familiar faces will we see from Stronghold Crusader 1?
Ah, good question. I can tell you that you'll see two familiar faces.
Two familiar faces?
Two familiar faces.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay.
So, I won't say any more than
right.
that.
Right, no spoilers, of
so
course.
So there'll be 8 AI characters at launch, and we've already revealed, I believe, 5 so far.
Okay.
So, you'll see 2 familiar faces. Who they are, I'm not going to say yet, but yes, some will definitely be returning.
Mr. No Life is starting to go into specifics about who specifically will be back.
Uh-oh.
We won't ruin that. But I hope that whets your appetite
the
a little bit.
The game's only going to be out in 3 months. So
okay.
It's September 2nd is our release date. So they'll know, you know, in good time. I'm basically the entire marketing department of Firefly, so it's all in my hands. Don't
right,
worry.
Right.
I will answer that guy's call.
Okay, that sounds good. So with the game coming out in 3 months, are you guys thinking yet about post-release plans, how you guys will continually work on the game?
Yeah, so, I mean, right now we're kind of, the game's at beta right now. It's pretty much feature complete. You know, we've got all the main core sort of features and things in there. But we're kind of mainly thinking about just finishing the game, getting it all polished. But we have got a plan for post-release. We're going to do sort of a mix of free updates and paid for DLCs. There'll be new features in there. One of them is extremely cool. I can't talk about it yet, but it's pretty awesome. And there'll be a mix of like other paid for DLC, like we're going to add new AI characters, and those will come with their own sort of mini campaigns. So yeah, we've got a plan for a mix of free and paid for post release DLC. Yeah, but it'll be cool. We're hoping to give the game sort of nice life after release, and it's going to ship with a map editor as well. So hopefully, with the original games, people used to make Lord of the Rings
right.
maps. So we're going to hopefully some Westeros and PlayStation there, and you know, get some cool user-generated content in the game.
Sure, sure. Now, we've got another question here. James Cole on Twitter is asking, do you have an advisor of any kind in Stronghold Crusader 2?
So we had, in the original game, we had the advisor in the bottom right corner. He was kind of described, we had the book open.
Yeah.
And what we wanted to do with Crusader 2 is make the sort of UI as minimalist and sort of, you know, sort of customizable as possible. So like if you see in the top right corner of the screen, Paul can click that little arrow in the top right and bring out all his information. But we wanted to keep it as fairly like sort of streamlined as possible, because I think, you know, UI in a RTS game, you know, you need the UI because there's so much information to take in. Mm-hmm. But we wanted to like the vast majority of the screen just to be the game, just to be the action, what's going on. So we've taken out the advisor, unfortunately. But yeah, he is sorely missed. But the game will still be fantastic. Don't worry about that.
James Cole, that doesn't preclude you from cosplaying as the advisor if you ever go to a video game convention. You know, you got to keep that spirit alive.
I'm actually going for a charity run in London in a couple of weeks' time, so I could go dressed as the advisor and hold the book the whole way.
Perfect. That's how running was meant to be done. It's what makes running tolerable, if you ask me. So how are we doing over here in this demo?
So Paul's managed to repel Rich's first attack, and as you can see, he's loaded up one of his trebuchets with sort of this Monty Python-esque sort of animal ammunition. So you can actually fire diseased cows, lions, camels into the enemy stronghold and sort of spread disease throughout their castle. It's just kind of like a bit of British humor.
Right.
Another way to like, you know, siege the castle. So you don't have to blast a hole in the wall. You can spread disease. You could, maybe he could burn down his farmlands outside and, you know, mess up his economy.
Yeah, a little psychological warfare.
Yeah, exactly. And yeah. We've also got the assassin, who's a sort of a new unit, not a new unit, but a returning unit from the original game. And he can actually scale the walls, steal the gatehouse and raise the gates. And then you can sort of charge your cavalry through. So we want to give, you know, it's not just about blowing down the walls is great fun.
Right.
But there's lots of options.
Okay. See what else I've got. See if Mr. No Life has any other questions about whether or not the rat will be back. Daniel Smith is asking about what variety of terrain will the game have?
Yeah, so I mean, I guess the one concern for players is that if it's the desert, is it all going to look the same? And the answer is no, because we've got sort of maps that have bodies of water, oases, mountains. You know, the desert is all just, you know, beige, you know, it's pretty varied, and we're hoping players can design their own sort of unique maps in the map editor as well, which basically gives them exactly the same tools we have, even as far as game logic and that kind of thing, so they can really create their own custom scenarios.
Is that map editor something that's going to be available at launch?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And then we're going to add Steam Workshop support as well.
Oh, wow.
Although there is the old school way of going online, finding a website, downloading a file, putting it in a folder, that's not much fun. So we're going to add Steam Workshop support, so it's just super easy to create content and share it with your friends.
Steam Workshop tends to be kind of opening up a can of worms in terms of creativity.
Yeah, but, you know, it's fun. You know, I mean, the original game, people have made such amazing like castles that we never would have, you know, if someone said to me before launch, oh yeah, I'm going to make Minas Tirith, I would say, nah, you're crazy. And then I see it downloaded and I'm like, how did they do this? So it's one of those things where we're kind of challenging the players to be as creative as they possibly can. And I want to see King's Landing. That would be nice. I want to see the whole thing recreated in Crusader 2.
I'm sure you will. And I'm sure you'll see plenty of pyros and heavies and everything else from the Valve universe.
So as you can see, Paul's managed to actually blow a hole in the wall of defences, and Rich has actually turned off all his industries outside the castle, because he knows that if he sends his peasants out there, Paul's forces are just going to absolutely, you know, wreck him apart. So you can actually do that. You can turn off industries, you can relocate your peasants. So if you want to pull your peasants back and turn them all into soldiers to repel an attack, you can do that. But it feels like after 3 days of demoing at E3, I think Paul's got pretty good at the demo, because he's doing pretty well at the moment. You can see him launching plenty of diseased animals into the castle and moving in with his Templar Knights. So yeah, so you can see Richard kind of on the top of the keep there in the middle of the castle. So yeah, the objective here is to kill the Lord, but the game will feature sort of the campaign, which will be a variety of different objectives. Uh-huh. Players can create their own objectives in the map editor. Yeah, and then the multiplayer mode will have your King of the Hills, your Capture the Flags, and things like that. But generally speaking, killing the enemy lord is the sort of, you know, the name of the game, really.
Okay. So, how would you compare this experience for somebody who's played the original Stronghold Crusader versus people who are brand new to it? Is there anything you're going to get out of it differently comparing those two?
I think if you played the original, there will be a massive hit of nostalgia as you load up the game and you enjoy it and you realize that this is a sequel worthy of the Crusader 2, the Crusader name. I mean, like I said earlier, we're actually self-publishing this, so we can spend as long as we want on, you know, we decide when the release date is, what features go in. Mm-hmm. You know, we've had so much feedback from the community. We've been at loads of consumer shows recently, and we're basically getting their feedback and implementing that stuff straight into the game. So it's kind of like we've been doing early access, but we haven't been on early access. You see what I mean? We've been like working with the community to make the game and improve it, sort of in the background. So I think people that already played the original game will find all the things very familiar, and you know, they'll see the new event system. So we've got tornadoes, earthquakes, locust swarms. That'll be really interesting for them. And the new unit abilities will be really cool. But if you've never played the games before, I mean, it's just a great RTS. You know, there are so few RTS games coming out, you know.
Right.
You know, it's kind of like everyone said the PC was dead. People are saying the RTS is dead, and then it's just going to come back and resurge.
So, sure.
For everyone else, yeah, it's just a fun, accessible sort of castle game that it's quite hard. You know, it's tough. Uh-huh. Even we find it quite difficult sometimes. But, it's a game that it's not like StarCraft Twitch sort of reactions. It's a bit more like planning ahead, you know, thinking about your strategy and, you know, sieging the castle in a way that, yeah, you know, you can sort of plan ahead and think about before you actually go in there.
This town has seen better days, I have to say.
It has, yeah. Paul's done a good job of destroying it. He's going for the church now.
Oh, no. Oh, gosh.
Yeah, I think when you've got, like, four trebuchets outside the castle and a massive war wolf, which is, like, the super catapult down there, you know, you're in a good position. See Richard in the corner there. AI will kind of taunt you throughout the match. You can make alliances with the AI. You can betray them. You can trade with them. And they'll kind of betray you sometimes as well. So, you know, it's fairly dynamic in that regard.
How long do the matches tend to stretch out?
Yeah, so I mean, you know, this is obviously designed for a show where we can demo it in like 15, 20 minutes. But it's funny, we actually specifically designed a multiplayer match for a consumer show a couple months back. And we thought, oh yeah, this is going to take max 20 minutes. And these two kids sat there and played for an hour and a half.
Yeah.
And we were just standing behind them like, you've got to move, you've got to let someone else play the game. So it's totally up to the people who are playing the game. You know, if they turtle a lot and they just defend and they build up their defenses,
right. It
could last longer. If they're really aggressive at the start, it could be over really quickly. So it very much depends on like the strategy of, you know, the players who are in the multiplayer match. But we tend to see maybe half an hour to an hour for an average game. Okay. But obviously with eight players, you know, it might be a bit longer than that. And the map scales all the way to like extra large as well, where it takes like 3 minutes for one unit to get across to the other side.
Right. Now you were talking about difficulty a moment ago, yeah. And I apologize if you might have mentioned this earlier, but in terms of tutorials, what are you guys looking to do?
So we're actually, the Stronghold games have always been quite hard.
Yeah.
And one thing we really want to do is, sort of smooth out that difficulty curve and give players an introduction to the game. So it'll actually be a tutorial campaign to start players off. So there's basically three main campaigns, tutorial, the Crusader campaign, and the Arabic sort of forces campaign. So the players will have to play through the tutorial campaign first to familiarize themselves with the game, because, you know, hard games are great, but they also need to teach the player
like,
the lessons early on. Otherwise, they're just dropping them in the deep end and it's like just, you know, fight for your life kind of thing. So support's kind of relying a bit more on the sort of heavily armored troops. They're a bit slower, but they're very resistant against archer fire. And the only thing that can really take out a fully armored unit like the Crusader Swordsman, the Knight Templar, is fire. So there are things like siege defenses like hay bale launchers that fire like flaming balls of hay. There are those pitch traps I showed you earlier. And those are kind of the surefire ways because when you're in a full set of armor, you're pretty well defended. But if there's a lot of fire around you, that's not going to be the best sort of suit to be in at the time.
I could see why.
Yeah. So you can see Paul sending out a burning cart there to set fire to some buildings. There's a whole range of siege equipment in the game. So we've got your battering rams, your ballista, trebuchets, catapults, but also fire is a big part of the game. So you can see his slave units there sort of with their torches setting fire to the buildings. And Richard doesn't look like he's in good state. I think Paul has claimed this victory. But he's going in for the kill now.
Well, can he do it? I have faith.
I think he can. Yeah, it's kind of like, we've taken our time with Crusader 2, and we know it's our fans' favorite Stronghold game, so we know we have to do it right. It has to be, polished at launch, bug-free, and, fun to play. And that's what people have been saying to us. They're really enjoying it. So it's kind of like the game we always wanted to make, really. And, now that we are in control of our own destiny, as it were, we can kind of, spend the time it takes to make a great game. And although we will be exclusive to PC at launch, post-release we are going to look to do a Mac and a Linux version as well. So
Okay. We're
going to stick to the mouse and keyboard because
that's
how you play RTS games, really. but yeah, we're looking to do those eventually, those three platforms.
No Steam controller support?
You know what? I think if Steam can send us over a prototype, we could have a look at it.
Uh-huh.
I saw some really interesting stuff with, I believe it was the Civ 5 and Rome as well. They were kind of looking at doing that. So, I mean, they did come to us at a very early stage with that and say, what do you guys think about RTS? How do you think it works? And we did say, if you give us a controller, we'd be happy to look at it. Because I like the ability to remap everything. Like, that's fantastic. And it could work. If there's any controller that can do it, I think that's the one.
Sure.
Yeah.
We'll jump back into some Twitter questions for a second. Sam Knoll is asking, Stronghold Crusaders 1 had some massive armies and battles. How big can the armies or battles get in Stronghold 2?
Yeah, so it'll depend on how many players are in the match at once. So if there's 8 players, the unit count will have to be pulled down a little bit just to keep things running smoothly. But as people die, as people drop out of the game, the unit count will raise up. And I'm pretty sure in the sort of 1 to 4 player range, you're going to have hundreds of units on screen at once. So we're fairly old school in that regard. It's crazy hard for the computer to process all that stuff, but that's what medieval battles were like.
Right.
Hundreds of guys going against each other. So it's kind of what we're trying to create.
So are these guys all just kind of holed up on the
roof
here?
Yeah, so what Richard's done is he's seen that his walls have been destroyed and he can't actually place new walls because Paul is so close to him.
Uh-huh.
So what he's decided to do is move all of his units up onto the top of the keep and sort of defend the king as much as they possibly can.
Okay.
But Paul's coming in there with some of the strongest units in the game, so they'll probably be able to take Richard out.
So what is the condition of victory here? Is it just completely eradicating?
The condition of victory is taking out Richard. Once Richard dies, the enemy sort of will lose. And we haven't quite decided what's going to happen to the rest of his castle when they lose. We're thinking about maybe, some kind of... We probably won't just give all the buildings to the other player, but we're thinking of some kind of system where we can kind of use those guys to hand them over to the other player. But we're not sure about that yet. But yeah, currently, once Richard dies, that's kind of the victory condition for an average skirmish game.
Right.
See them walking in there quite proudly. The only disadvantage of really heavily armored units is that they're slower than your average guys. So
right.
The archers will run, but they'll get taken out just like that. So he's bravely gone up to the top of the keep now and swarmed Richard. So this is like how medieval battles actually happened back in the day. It wasn't this one-on-one. You wouldn't get to the top of the keep and then one guy would challenge Richard. There you go. So Richard's... It's a slight visual bug at the moment where all the buildings disappear.
Right,
and
the whole thing is gone.
Yeah, Richard pushed the self-destruct button.
Yeah.
But that's kind of, see in the corner there, you can see 30-minute game. you know, in the final version, players will be able to see their gameplay stats after each match, so you can see where people started to sell resources, start their attack, you know, when their economy started going, and our players love that kind of thing, especially after you've been playing a multiplayer match for, like, you know, 2 hours or maybe even more. So.
Right.
Yeah, so we're coming out, you know, on Steam on 7th of September 2014, and it's going to be a great game. We're enjoying it in the office, so that's usually a good sign. And people seem to be enjoying it at shows, so it's great.
All right. Now, I'm not sure if I'm not allowed to let you go yet. You might be. Okay. You might have been on the hook for a little bit more time.
That's okay.
Do you think we can get another quick match going on here?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. I'll try to communicate to the guys inside the booth. Let's get another quick match going on here before we let Nick run off. That's the little movie magic here. I can talk to the producers behind stage, this little guy right here. We'll see if they actually heard me. All right, here we go. We've got another 10 minutes. Let's see what we can pull off in 10 quick minutes. So this is a good opportunity to kind of like give us a refresher course for anybody who might have tuned in toward the end of that last playthrough here.
Sure, sure.
Just, you know, what the blank slate is like at the beginning of a Stronghold Crusader 2 match.
So, I mean, at the start of the match, obviously, we've set this up to be a little bit faster than, you know, the traditional match would go, because we have to keep it to a fairly short demo. But so we've built your sort of your walls. Paul's got kind of a Helm's Deep style thing going on to the top right. But in an average match, you'd only have your keep at the start, which is actually this building just above the windmill. And you'd be free to design your castle however you want, essentially. So you'd place your stockpile where all your resources are stored to create buildings and troops. You'd put your granary down where all your food is stored. And then you basically, it'd be totally up to you how to design your castle. You can build sort of killing zones where you have a very sort of thin wall that people break through, and then you have like all these traps waiting from inside, and you know, you can line your walls with archers, stick, you know, 10, 20 archers in each tower, and you're basically free to design your castle however you want. We basically just set this up for demo purposes, but yeah, it's totally up to you. And you know, when you see a new map, you'll kind of have to assess the situation. You see where the resources are, where you want to put your stockpile and your granary, you know, where it's going to be the most efficient. You know, you've got to build your buildings close to each other so the peasants don't have to travel very far. Because the shorter distance they have to travel, the faster you can produce your weapons, your armor, your resources. And we've got this sort of new, another way we're kind of bringing the 2D gameplay of the original game into the 3D engine is by having this wall system where walls just click together. You place them in one of 8 directions, and it's very easy to layer them up. And, you know, create sort of these special zones where if you want to protect a certain part of your economy, you know, if you're really protective of your armory and all your weapons, you can lock that off and defend that really well. And it's kind of one of those ironic things where in the original 2D game, it was actually a limitation, but it made for way better gameplay. So, like, you know, in past games, we've had the system where you can build walls at any angle and buildings at any angle and rotate them. And it looks great in screenshots, but when it comes to actual gameplay, like, this just works way better. It's so much faster. It's so much more fun for players. And it's just more intuitive, really. Like, that's the main thing. We want the gameplay to be as intuitive as possible because the game's hard. So
right.
It needs to be as... it needs to be as, you know, easy to grasp as possible.
It looks like the castle of a man who's only got about 10 minutes worth of time to play and knows that he's not going to get to the end of this match.
It's not beautiful, but it'll work.
No, it's functional. There's a few kind of dead-end courtyards in there that don't really go anywhere. Yeah. But
it's funny as well because players don't think that, you know, they don't know exactly how the game's designed, but creating a sort of a system where you can run units up on walls and over gatehouses and through gatehouses is actually quite complex in the way that the pathfinding works. So you have to have one path going through, one path going up and over another path. So it's quite complex, and you know, it's quite fun. It's quite satisfying being able to run your troops along all the castle walls. We had a game recently where a guy was basically only had his lord left and he was completely done for. So he actually ran his warlord up the wall and created new walls and then just kept running away and creating new walls. So there are some interesting tactics that can come out of that. And we're hoping with, we're actually going to have a co-op mode in the game as well. I may have said this earlier. So when you sort of control the same castle, the same resources, the same units, and we're hoping some fairly sort of, you know, interesting tactics come out of that, but it's very much something that we're kind of just putting in the game and hoping the players kind of, you know, take on board.
It's one of those modes where you're putting a lot of trust in the strength of people's friendships.
Oh yeah, yeah. I mean, like, we had to add, you know, we were kind of thinking about what features did we need to add for launch, and someone said, yeah, we probably need voice chat because doing co-op without voice chat is going to be just insane. You know, no one's going to know what's going on. So. Yeah, we have a lot of faith in our community. Yeah, we've seen what they can do with the map editor. We've seen what crazy stuff they can do with that. So I'm sure co-op will be a walkover for them.
Sure. Come on, dog.
Mars.
Paul's actually defending his troops there with these mantlets. So these are kind of like, you know, you can set everything up into a formation. So he's set those mantlets up in a formation at the front, so they'll take any archer fire and protect his troops at the back, which is a huge advantage when you're attacking a castle and you've got walls lined with hundreds of archers.
Let's see, UNSC Spartan on Twitter asks about the idea of naval combat. Is that something that you guys are thinking about?
So we are going to have sort of visual sort of ships to the game as part of the campaign, you know, because how else would like Richard get into the Middle East?
Right.
So they're very much a visual part of the game, but we're not adding ships just because we kind of feel like it would take on a different... We want to keep the game medieval. We want to keep it sort of true to the sort of stronghold thing. There's no magic in the game, for instance. There's no, like, technology that you wouldn't expect in medieval times.
Right.
We used a little bit of artistic license with the catapulting of, you know, diseased animals and stuff. Although that did, you know, that was used as a tactic. So they're going to be, you know, just purely visual. We're going to keep the game medieval. We know from experience that our fans love the medieval stuff the most. You know, we don't have any orcs, no elves, there's no magic in the games.
Uh-huh.
I kind of feel like that's what sets us apart. So we're going to keep it medieval and keep it pure Stronghold, I think.
And as you said before, you know, you guys are a team of about five people, you said?
It's five core devs, yeah.
That's stretching yourselves pretty thin if you take on something like naval combat with all the systems that implies.
That's a fantastic point, yes. Yeah. I mean, like, it's quite funny because we've heard people say, oh, you know, the game looks really nice. I really like the look of the game. And I said, yeah, I'll tell the two artists we have working that you said that. They'll be really happy to hear that.
Right.
So, it's also about, like you said, concentrating on the core gameplay systems, getting them really fun, really polished, and anything else, you know, sort of thinking about that post-release, and if we wanted to add any new features, you know, thinking about that after-release, after the game's come out, and everything's, we want everything just to be polished, fun, and, you know, locked down, and really, really sort of solid.
Engineers at your service.
How's this strategy comparing from that initial run-through?
So Paul's kind of using a few more catapults this time. He's not really going for the disease route. He's mainly going for the just blow a hole in the walls. You know, because we actually haven't got the assassins in this demo, but if he had them, he could kind of steal the gatehouse, raise the gate. So there's a few other options, but he's kind of going more for the brute force this time, just trying to blow a hole in the walls and not really opting for the diseased animals.
It's very kind of him.
Yes.
Very,
especially to the animals.
Yeah.
Although they are dead, and no animals were hurt in the making of this game.
Right. Those animals are already dead.
And they died of natural causes.
Yes,
well.
Yes. Don't worry about that.
Yeah, you can see a few of the options when it comes to siege equipment there. You know, your battering rams, your burning carts. It's mainly just about, you know, the fun that comes with destroying someone else's castle that they've spent an hour carefully crafting. You know, we like to encourage multiplayer in the game as well. It's going to have, you know, update players. And you can play in however you want in terms of AI, human opponents. You can do co-op online as well. So it's all about giving people as many options when it comes to defending their castles as it does when it's, you know, when they're attacking it as well. It's kind of putting a few more hovels there to increase his popularity his population. Because as soon as the kind of difference between Stronghold and other RTS games is that you have to have the economy going before you can attack. You can't just like sort of rush them right at the start of the match, just create
right.
like 50 guys. You have to have the economy going. It has to be sort of, you know, a bit more sort of long term planning. So that's kind of the main difference. You have to get your castle economy going. And if someone destroys your economy, that's like a perfectly valid tactic for them to just completely, you know,
sure.
ruin your day. Self-publishing allows us to spend a bit more time on sort of little features of the game as well. Like in the original game, if you told your troops to go up and attack a castle wall, they'd kind of take out their nice, shiny, sharp sword and just start hacking away the wall, which didn't really make sense. So
right. We
kind of saw this halfway through production and thought, let's just spend a day or two adding some new animations and making them actually like rip the wall apart with actual tools. So, you know, we were looking at the towers and working a bit more on the sort of tower destruction stuff. So it's nice to be able to spend that extra time and make those decisions ourselves to put extra polish into little parts of the game that players notice. And those little things kind of add up and eventually, you know, make for a more sort of, you know, polished experience overall. So we think it's worth it in the end.
So we've only got a couple minutes left here, and we've covered a lot so far. Is there anything else that you think is worth discussing that we haven't really gone over yet?
I think the main thing is just to know that sort of, you know, it's a fully, in terms of content, it's quite a plentiful game. You've got two single-player campaigns, multiplayer for up to 8 players. There will be over 20 units in the game, over half of which have unique abilities, like the Sergeant at Arms is kind of a bannerman. You can raise morale of troops near him. The Slave Driver can motivate slave units nearby him. You've got your mounted units who can do like a charge. So there's loads of like little unit abilities in the game that makes, we're not going full MOBA when it comes to this kind of thing,
right,
but
yeah.
You know, we're spicing up the Crusader formula and adding some of the things that just makes each unit a bit more unique and makes it a bit more interesting how you actually use each unit in the game.
All right, cool. Well, Nick, thank you so much for that extended demo of Stronghold Crusader 2. You mentioned this earlier, but go ahead and reiterate it for the people who might have missed it before. Release plans?
Release date is 2nd of September 2014. We'll be on Steam. We're PC at our hearts, but post-release we'll kind of be looking to do maybe Mac and Linux ports. So, 2nd of September, it will be a fantastic game. We're really enjoying it in the office, so hopefully, you know, the players will as well.
All right, sounds great. So there you have it. That was Stronghold Crusader 2. We're going to take a quick little break and be right back, so stay tuned.